Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Witch's Cauldron by Ella Summers. Narrated by Cris. Chapter 1. Do or Die. An angel stood behind me, his arms locked across mine in an iron grip. I pulled and pushed and heaved, but he didn't budge an inch. Angels were stubborn like that. "I have you right where I want you," I told him, yanking on his arms.
"And where is that?"
Nero didn't move. He was like a mountain of muscle and infuriating willpower. I looked up at the high ceiling of the gym, searching for insight that didn't come. I had no idea how I was going to get out of this situation, but I wasn't about to tell him that. Fake it until you make it. "Give me a moment, and you'll see," I declared. I continued to push against his hold. I had the strength of a vampire, but while that gave me the edge I needed against humans, it was wholly useless against angels. They had the strength of vampires too, and then some.
"I'm waiting,"
he said, a hint of amusement breaking through the hard shell of his words. "Almost there," I puffed out. "And it's gonna be epic."
"Take your time,"
he chuckled. Apparently, my useless attempts to free myself were enormously funny. I tried to shift my weight to slide my arms out of his grip, but he wasn't having any of that. No matter what I did, his hold didn't relax, not even for a second. As I slammed my back into him, I became acutely aware of the hard contours of his chest. My eyes dipped to his arms, thick and tight around me. I was hit with the sudden urge to see the rest of him, to touch and taste the rest of him. I shoved that thought right out of my head. There would be no touching and absolutely no tasting. I had an unhealthy addiction to Nero's blood. It was like a drug I couldn't get enough of. Even now, I could feel his pulse popping against my skin, tempting me. I blamed the vampire magic the Legion of Angels had given me. I wasn't a vampire per se, but I did have their abilities and their hunger. If I lived long enough, I'd receive the magic of a whole bunch of other supernaturals, too.
"You might want to rethink your strategy, Leda,"
Nero said, his breath hot on my neck. Gods, he was making it hard to concentrate. Not that he was doing anything. Well, besides standing there, slowly squeezing the air out of my lungs. His scent flooded me, the scent of angel and sex. I shook my head. Whoa, where did that come from? It must be the delirium setting in as my body screamed for oxygen. I had to get free. I tried to push back, to slam him against the wall. His feet remained planted to the ground. He was too strong. I kicked back at his shins, but he blocked me with his feet. How could he even move that fast? "You aren't making this easy," I growled, stomping down on his foot. At least, I tried to. He moved his foot aside, and my heel thumped against the gym floor.
"That's the point."
I threw back my head, slamming it into his face. He still didn't budge, even though that must have hurt like hell. Well, it had hurt me. Spots danced in front of my eyes, rapid and blinking. Breathing was getting difficult. The next thing I knew, I was facing Nero, his hands locked on my arms, holding me up. I blinked back blackness, trying to focus. I'd passed out again. That was the third time today, and it wasn't even dawn yet. Nero stepped back.
"Again."
I groaned. Just the thought of fighting him again made every bone in my body scream and protest.
"That is not an attitude befitting a soldier of the Legion,"
he lectured me.
"We must be strong, dignified, unerring."
It's hard to be any of those things at 5 o'clock in the morning.
"So you wish to stop our training sessions?"
"No." I shook out my arms and legs. "I can do this." Nero had been working with me every morning before everyone else got up for normal training. He was helping me get strong, and I did appreciate it. Okay, maybe not so much, when I was stuck in the middle of that help, which often felt more like torture. A busy angel like Nero had better things to do than babysit a first-level soldier like me. And yet, here he was, waking up early too when he could have just slept in. Instead, he was spending this time with me, training me. I didn't want to disappoint him, and more than that, I couldn't afford to give up. Getting knocked around the room a few times was nothing compared to what lay before me. I needed to be ready. He motioned me forward and I began walking toward him.
Stop,
he said. I froze. What?
What have you learned?
To follow your orders? I'd tried to maintain a perfectly serious face, but mischief must have sparkled in my eyes because he sighed. He stepped around me, locking me in that unbreakable hold again.
Your opponent has trapped you like this. What do you do?
He asked me. Stomp on your feet? Kick your shins? I said immediately. But you're too fast.
What else?
Slam my head back into your face. For all the good it had done me last time. Nero was too stubborn to flinch. If anything, he'd held on even more tightly. None of that works on you, though. You're too big. Too strong, too heavy.
Use that against me,
he said, each word vibrating with delicious warmth as it fell on my throat. My pulse popped hard against my skin, the blood rushing like a burning river, searing my veins, begging him to bite me. I thought back to the last time he'd bitten me. The memory shot a ruthless primal desire through me, stripping away all propriety and reason. The rational part of my brain was hanging on by a thin strand. But I had to hold on. I cleared my throat and said,
How do I use your strength against you?
My voice creaked as pitifully as my sore bones.
Lean over,
Nero said, hardly above a whisper. He pressed his body hard against mine, the pressure making me bend at the waist and think really indecent thoughts.
Use my own weight to throw me.
He straightened, but the pressure remained. He'd committed most of his weight forward.
No.
I moved quickly, using his weight to pull him over my shoulder, and sure enough, I was able to throw him. My victory was short-lived, however. Even as he fell, he didn't let go of my arms, and so I fell too, landing on him. Before I could move, he flipped us over, so that he was on top of me. I tried to struggle free, but of course I couldn't. The damn angel had pinned me to the floor. I glared up at him.
Glaring is not an effective attack,
he said smugly. I imagined his head exploding. I broadcast that picture to him loud and clear. He had telepathic magic, so he might just pick it up. His mouth curled into a smile.
Yes, that attack would work better. If you had such an ability, as it is, you'll just have to make do with what you do have.
What's the point of telling me how to get out of your hold if I can't actually get out of your hold? I demanded. Nero rolled back, sliding up to his feet.
Because it will work on most of the opponents you face, even if it doesn't work on me.
He extended his hand down to me, pulling me up. You're really arrogant, you know?
I'm an angel.
Yeah, I know. Arrogance comes with the wings.
This isn't about arrogance. Angels are faster and more resilient than other people, as you well know.
Yeah, I did know. I had learned a lot from Nero and used it on my opponents in training. Like he said, the things he taught me were effective against most people. In fact, they worked really well. You could let me win once in a while, I said.
And what purpose would that serve?
It would make me feel better.
It would make you feel better to know that I let you win?
His eyebrows crept up. Yes, I said stubbornly.
That's not how we do things here.
I sighed. I know. The Legion of Angels was a do-or-die kind of place. Our magic was gifted to us by the gods, a new power every time we advanced up the ranks. It was kind of like a really twisted real-life video game. With each new level, Legion soldiers received the powers of a different supernatural. Boosts, like the physical abilities of vampires, the potion brewing power of witches, and the healing magic of fairies. The catch, and oh yes, there was a big one, was if your will wasn't strong enough to absorb the gift, it killed you, outright. Just 2 months ago, I'd watched over 20 people die during my initiation ceremony into the Legion. Even more of my fellow initiates died when we'd all drunk from the nectar of the gods to receive our first gift, Vampire's Kiss. The Legion took all kinds of people. Those who wanted to prove themselves, those who craved power, and those who were simply desperate. I was of the glorious latter category. I joined the Legion to gain telepathic magic, a skill called Ghost's Whisper. It would give me the ability to link into the minds of my loved ones, and that power was my only chance of finding my kidnapped brother. The only problem was Ghost's Whisper was a level 9 ability in the Legion. In order to gain it, I'd have to survive all the trials before it. That included getting my wings and becoming an angel. It was called the Legion of Angels because the angels commanded the gods' army, but there weren't many angels in the world. Very few made it that far up the Legion. But I had to. My brother was counting on me to beat the odds, and if there was one thing I excelled at, it was my unwavering stubbornness. So I stared that angel down and resolved to kick his ass. Nero nodded in approval.
We'll go again.
I began to circle around him. Will I ever be able to defeat you?
After you've gained more powers.
And before that? His face was unreadable, as cold as marble.
Perhaps.
How?
You have to find my weaknesses and exploit them.
Care to share? He remained silent. Yeah, I didn't think so. He wasn't going to hand me anything. He was going to make me fight for it. I swung a punch at him, but he caught my fist, holding me back. You know, you are really aggravating, I told him. He said nothing, but I thought I caught a hint of amusement on his face. Just a second before his grip tightened, and he flipped me down to the floor. I rolled, jumping up. I need a weapon, I commented.
The rules of this match are quite clear. No weapons.
Yeah, I know. You love your rules. Sometimes we fought with no weapons. Sometimes we fought with just one particular weapon. Nero defined the rules of each match very clearly. He wanted to make sure I was a master of any weapon, and that I stopped using found objects to fight. I wasn't allowed to knock my opponent upside the head with a trash can lid, even if that lid was lying right there, just begging to be used. Apparently, such tactics weren't very dignified, and soldiers of the Legion were always dignified. How about I get a weapon and you don't? I suggested, smirking at him.
There's little value in teaching you to fight only in situations where you are at an advantage over your opponent.
Instead, I should always be at a disadvantage, I muttered.
Besides,
he continued as though I hadn't said a thing,
I don't think giving you a weapon would be the advantage you think it is.
Because you would just steal it and use it against me, I realized. He nodded. And you claim you're civilized. You're just as dirty as I am. His eyebrows arched. You know what I mean, I said, flushing. He swung at me. I ducked, avoiding his fist. Huh, I wasn't as strong as Nero, but I was quick. Just not quick enough. Moving so fast that his hand was a blur, he followed up with a punch that knocked me to the floor.
Get up,
he said over my aching body. Rather than get up, though, I just lay there this time, pretending to be unconscious. Nero might have been a hard ass, but he was helping me. He was training me, and not because he liked hurting me. He knew about my brother, knew that he was a telepath, but he was keeping it from the gods, who would try to find Zane themselves and force him into their service. Nero was doing all of this for me. Maybe I was his weakness. So I waited until he bent down to check on me. Then I quickly kicked out, knocking him down. As soon as he hit the floor, I jumped on top of him, pinning him down. I opened my mouth to laugh out in victory, but the angel knocked me off of him with a blast of telekinetic magic. Hey! I shouted, scrambling to my feet. No magic, that's not fair.
Since when has war ever been fair?
So I have to play by your rules, but you don't?
Yes.
I glowered at him.
And pretending to be unconscious was not befitting of a soldier of the Legion.
He said, but it wasn't against your rules.
It was implied.
He was so close now, almost within striking distance. Before I could contemplate the recklessness of what I was about to do, I surged forward straight at him. My impulsiveness paid off. I landed a blow to his stomach. Nero's eyes flashed in surprise, but he quickly recovered. I didn't get in another hit. He grabbed me and slammed me to the ground. My back hit the floor with the resounding thump of defeat, and he pinned me down for the 53rd time today.
I hate you.
I growled up at him.
I warned you that you would hate me before this was over.
I will get back at you, I promised. He stared down at me with perfect calmness.
And how are you going to do that?
By sabotaging the hot water on the 23rd floor so you get only ice water when you turn on your shower. Or by sneaking into your apartment and spreading superglue all across the insides of your clothes.
I would have to punish your transgression.
He warned me. I clenched my jaw. Get out of my head. Usually I could keep him out so that he only saw what I chose to broadcast to him.
Your emotions are running hot right now. Your thoughts are so vivid that it's hard to ignore them.
He said, his hands tightening around mine. I trailed my gaze up the hard, merciless muscles in his arms, all the way up to his chest, which was taut beneath the thin fabric of his shirt. It was a good thing my hands were pinned over my head, because I would have had a hard time resisting the urge to scrape my fingernails across his chest and down his back.
That would be inappropriate,
he told me. And yet he leaned in, inhaling deeply as though he were drinking in my scent. There were a lot of things an angel with his heightened senses could tell from my scent. Things I didn't want him knowing any more than I wanted him inside of my head. I swallowed hard, trying to shield my mind and calm my racing pulse. I didn't care much if he caught me fantasizing about playing pranks on him. But I didn't want him to see me fantasizing about less innocuous things. Naked things. A sexy smile twisted Nero's lips. Shit. He'd heard that too. But he didn't say a thing. He just stared down at me, his mouth dangerously close to mine, his chest brushing against me each time he breathed. The door to the gym hall closed loudly. I turned my head and looked at the woman who'd just entered, dressed in a black leather Legion uniform that was as black as her chin-length hair. She was gorgeous. Between her dark hair and pale skin, she looked like Snow White. Well, if Snow White were a soldier of the Legion rather than a fictitious fairy tale princess. Colonel Windstriker, she said, her words pulsing with strength beneath the melodic lilt of her voice. Am I interrupting something? Her blue eyes darted to me.
No.
Nero rose quickly, hurrying toward her. Then he dropped to his knees before her.
My apologies, First Angel.
So this beautiful stranger was an angel. No, not just an angel, the top angel of the Legion, the leader of the God's army. What was she doing here? The first angel lifted her hands. Rise. Nero did as she'd asked, but he didn't say anything. He simply looked at her, waiting for her to speak again. Her gaze flickered to me once more before settling on him.
Come with me, Colonel. We have much to discuss.
He walked with her across the gym hall, stopping at the door to call back to me.
Get moving. Captain Somerset's expecting you in Hall 4 in half an hour.
Then he turned and followed the first angel out of the room. Chapter 2. Infinite Impossibilities. After Nero and the first angel left the gym hall, I hurried down the corridor to Demeter, the Legion's canteen. I grabbed a quick breakfast of scrambled eggs, toast, and orange juice. Then joined my friends Ivy and Drake at our usual table. They looked fresh and awake this morning. They must have gotten to the coffee before it had run out. It always ran out before I got here. Every single morning. The cynic in me was convinced Nero purposely kept me in training until the morning coffee was gone. The angel believed any weakness, even a minor one, like caffeine dependence, was a mortal failing in a soldier of the Legion. I'd noticed it had been getting easier to wake up since I'd ditched the morning coffee, but I wasn't about to tell him that. I wasn't even going to think it, in case he managed to tune into my thoughts again. I saved a donut for you, Ivy said, her long red hair bouncing off her shoulders as she turned her head to look up at me. Thanks, I replied, sitting down opposite her and Drake. Ivy had the body of a supermodel, but she'd put on more muscle in the past 2 months. Drake had the wide shoulders and build of a football player, which he'd been before joining the Legion. But his smile was so good-natured, so friendly. If I hadn't seen him tear werewolves apart with his bare hands, I'd have had a hard time believing he could ever get angry. But as soon as Ivy had been in danger, he'd broken through those werewolves. No fear in him, only rage, like a switch had been flipped inside of his brain. The two of them looked so beautiful together, even though they weren't actually together. They were both wearing the standard Legion workout suits, just like I was. But they hadn't been training since 5 a.m, so their clothes were unwrinkled and clean. And they didn't smell like sweat and Angel. Ivy's gaze panned down my body. "Early morning?" she asked, a smile spreading her mouth. "Too early, like every morning." I took a bite out of the donut. A jolt of energy shook my body. Whoa. Did I mention I'm not a morning person? Drake laughed. Only every single morning. I laughed, finishing up the donut. Whatever magic was in it, I wanted more. What I wouldn't give for a long bath. I shared a dorm room with 5 people. We had 1 shower and no bathtub. I rolled back my neck, stretching out the stiffness in it. A long bath and a massage. I sighed. Ivy smirked at me. Why don't you ask Colonel Sexy Pants for a massage? That was her name for Nero. I bet he'd oblige. She added with a mischievous twinkle in her brown eyes. I poked the eggs on my plate. He was too busy throwing me across the gym to listen to requests for a massage. You two sure have been spending a lot of time together. She said, people are talking, especially the brats. The Legion brats were people with an angel parent, and there were 6 of them in our initiation class. Their bloodline ensured they had more magic in them than most people, and they'd been trained from birth to join the Legion like their parents before them. They also had the egos to go with their esteemed pedigree. What do the brats say? I asked. That you're failing combat training and had to take remedial classes? Drake said. But they're just jealous they don't have a sexy angel training them one-on-one. Ivy added quickly. Training with an angel is not all it's cracked up to be, you know. I told them. I wasn't kidding about that bath and massage. I feel like my body has been put through a meat grinder. Didn't he heal you? Ivy asked. No, he got distracted. She wiggled her eyebrows at me. I'll bet. No, not like that. The first angel walked into our training session. I spread raspberry marmalade across my toast. I wonder what she's doing here. She's here to investigate the supernaturals in New York in the aftermath of what happened last month, said Ivy. Her team's rounding up vampires, witches, and shifters all over the city and interrogating them, trying to figure out how much of a foothold into this world the demons have gotten. They believe the demons are still recruiting for their army. How can you possibly know about this? I chatted with Captain Horn and Lieutenant Bradshaw on the way to breakfast this morning, and they told me. She said, as though it were perfectly normal for 2 officers of the Legion to openly share information like that. Then again, people were always telling Ivy things. It was astounding how much she could get out of someone just by smiling at them. The first angel thinks the demon's influence on Earth is stronger than we thought. And she believes that even though the Legion took out the operation at Sweet Dreams, this is far from over. Ivy's smile faded during that last sentence. Her mother had been the one behind recruiting people for the demon's army, the act of a desperate woman dying of cancer. In exchange for the demons making her immortal, she'd made a deal with them to set up this operation. She hadn't told Ivy about any of this. Ivy had found out the hard way. After the battle at the Sweet Dreams Bakery, I'd had to be the one to tell my friend that her mother was dead. 1 month later, Ivy was still struggling with her conflicting feelings. On the one hand, Rose had been the head of recruitment for a demon army. On the other hand, she was Ivy's mother. Ivy loved her mother, but hated what she'd done. The whole thing was tearing her up inside. I reached across the table and gave Ivy's hand a good squeeze. She squeezed me back, wiping her tears away and putting on a happy face. She wasn't the best fighter in our group, but she was more resilient than people gave her credit for. After breakfast, we headed over to Hall 4, where Captain Somerset was waiting for us. Nero had overseen our initial training, but as the top-ranking person in New York and the only angel, he had more important things to do than to spend his days torturing lowly soldiers. That was now Captain Somerset's job, and she took that job very seriously. We approached cautiously to see what the good captain had for us today. Yesterday, it had been a field trip to the plains of monsters, to go hunting for a pack of firewolves. As someone who'd grown up next door to the Plains of Monsters, I'd learned that you never crossed that big stone and magic wall standing between us and the beasts who'd taken over half of the Earth. Sure, I'd ignored that sensible rule a few times in my years as a bounty hunter, but I'd never gone hunting for monsters out there. It was insane. When I'd told Captain Somerset that, she'd responded that the Legion didn't require sanity from its soldiers, only obedience. She'd almost managed to keep a straight face as she'd said it. Today's offering wasn't monsters or field trips beyond the wall. Instead, Captain Somerset had set us up in the gym hall with an obstacle course of infinite impossibilities.
"Coming closer now. Don't be shy,"
she said, grinning. She might have been trying to kill us, but at least she was doing it with a smile.
"What is that?"
Torin said, his eyes widening as he looked up at the obstacle course looming over us like a storm cloud ready to let loose.
"That is your latest challenge," Captain Somerset declared.
"That's not challenging, it's impossible," Lucy gasped.
"Some of those jumps aren't even doable,"
Lyle agreed.
"You have supernatural skills," the captain reminded us. "You have the speed, strength, and stamina of vampires."
"And the self-healing, too," said Roden, one of the brats. "If we fall and get hurt, we can just nibble a little on Ivy's neck to heal ourselves."
He flashed her a grin, and the other brats chuckled. Ivy smiled at them.
"Sorry, not my type." Everyone knew Ivy had a thing for the Legion officers, and that they had a thing for her.
"Okay, enough chit-chat. Shut up and listen," Captain Somerset told us.
Had Nero been here, he would have made us run laps or do push-ups for talking. He believed if you had enough energy to talk, you weren't pushing yourself hard enough, and so he pushed you harder. But Nero wasn't here, and I really needed to stop thinking about him. Obsessing over an angel wasn't healthy. I had to get a new hobby, like eating chocolate. There wasn't anything unhealthy about that.
"You will begin the course with a dash across these raised platforms," Captain Somerset said. "But beware, if you put your weight on any one of them for too long, it will drop to the floor. The final platform in the sequence leads to a big jump, directly onto this climbing wall." She indicated a leap worthy of a spider. "The climb will bring you to your next challenge." She walked beneath a series of wooden posts 20 feet up. Hall floor had the highest ceiling of any of the Legion's gyms. Maybe this was where they taught angels how to fly. No, come to think of it, they probably just pushed new angels off the roof of the building. That was more like the Legion style. "Jump from one post to the next until you reach the tightrope," she said. "After a quick walk across the rope, a jump into this vertical tunnel awaits you. Next is a dash through a labyrinth. Some of the walls are equipped with motion sensors and will shoot out smoke and debris at you as you pass." Someone coughed in disbelief behind me, but I wasn't surprised. For the past 2 months, the Legion had been putting us into one difficult situation after the other, and they'd made no secret of the fact that they didn't expect all of us to survive. From the 50 people who'd shown up at the initiation ceremony, only 16 of us remained. "After you escape the labyrinth of exploding walls, a door stands in your way." She led us to a metal door we all knew well. It was identical to the ones Nero had put us in front of every day for weeks. He'd made us punch the door again and again, until our hands bled, and we'd learned to tune out that pain. He'd called it an exercise in willpower, and it really was. It had taken enormous willpower not to punch him instead. As it was, I'd just imagined his face on the door while punching it. But I wasn't supposed to be thinking about Nero. I returned my full attention to Captain Somerset. "Each time you punch the door, it will open a little more, until the opening is wide enough for you to go through," she explained, passing the door. "On the other side, your final challenge awaits." She indicated a bar used for pull-ups, except these weren't mere pull-ups in store for us. To complete this challenge, we had to hop the bar up a series of levels until we reached the top, and then we had to hop the bar back down again, level by level. The best part was we had to do all of this while our hands were still bleeding from punching that door, however many times it took to open it. "After you're finished with the salmon ladder, hop down onto the landing platform. Then run 10 laps on the track before you get in line for the course again," Captain Somerset finished.
She put half of us in line in front of the obstacle course and assigned the other half to run laps as they waited. I was third in line. I watched two others struggle through the obstacles before me. We were all still working on mastering our vampire abilities, some of us more than others. After all, it hadn't been so many weeks ago that we'd received the god's first gift. When the Legion didn't have a job for us, we trained the whole day long. Lots and lots of training. The key to surviving the gods' gifts of magic was willpower, so every training session we did was designed to force our bodies and minds to the breaking point. I pushed through the course, refusing to give up even as it tested my muscles in new and excruciating ways. I had to make it through, to make my body accept all the magic I'd been given. It was not automatic. You had to master one gift before you got the next. That was how the Legion of Angels worked. And I had 8 more levels to go before I could gain the power I needed to find my brother. I'd made it past the insanity of the exploding walls and was halfway through the final challenge when Nero stepped into the gym hall. He looked fresh out of the shower, every drop of water visible in his mostly dry hair. I watched him walk across the room to Captain Somerset, and my distracted mind caught me. My hand slipped and I nearly fell off my bar. I could have sworn I caught a hint of amusement on his lips before it was swallowed by his usual marble expression. Cursing that arrogant angel, I powered through the rest of the course, then hopped down. I closed up beside Ivy on the track, and we ran our 10 laps together. As we entered the line for round 2, Drake was just entering the obstacle course. Ivy's eyes were glued to him, so, of course, I had to tease her about it. "Enjoying the show?" I asked her, keeping my voice low so Nero didn't hear me. If he realized I was chatting, he'd assign me more laps. "Are you?" Ivy shot back with a grin, her eyes darting between me and Nero. His stare honed in on us as though he'd heard us. He opened his mouth, but his phone rang at that moment, saving the day. "Not that I blame you," Ivy added, sighing. "That angel looks good enough to eat." "Nah," I'd choke on all the feathers. The corner of Ivy's mouth drew up into a smirk. "He's really helped you, Leda. You're getting faster and stronger every day." "Tell that to my ribs," I said, pulling up my shirt to show her the bruised skin on my side. "Those are impressive love marks, honey." "You can see the imprint of his fist. I'd hardly call that a love mark." Ivy shrugged. "He's an angel." It was her turn to take on the obstacle course, so she hurried forward.
"No, I'll handle this myself,"
Nero said into his phone, walking toward me. He slid the phone into his jacket.
"Pandora,"
he said, using his nickname for me.
"Fire Swift, Ravenfall."
He motioned to Jace and Mina, two of the Legion brats. Apparently there was some unspoken Legion rule that stated the children of angels got to be called by their parents' esteemed surnames, those magical names bestowed upon Legion soldiers when they became angels, rather than being stuck with mocking nicknames like the rest of us.
"Come with me."
We followed Nero out of the gym hall, leaving the others to deal with Captain Somerset's obstacle course. Hellish as it was, I had a feeling it was harmless compared to whatever Nero was about to have us do. He didn't leave the office to rescue cats from trees or to parade down the street for the delight of the city's residents.
"There's been an attack on the city,"
Nero said, not slowing for a second as he led us down the corridor toward the Legion's garage. "What kind of attack?" I asked.
"Every single person in a 10-story building suddenly dropped dead."
Chapter 3. The New York Massacre. When we arrived at the Brick Palace, the site of the attack, the paranormal police were already there. We got out of the truck, following Nero past a dozen police officers, every single one of them gaping at us as we entered the building. Well, we did look menacing in our black leather uniforms, but that was the point. The Legion was able to maintain order on Earth because everyone was afraid of us. That fear started with the black battle leather and weapons, but the outfits weren't everything. During the drive over here, Nero had lectured us on the importance of maintaining a menacing demeanor. No laughing or smiling or joking. We were supposed to walk around like we were ready to kill anyone at any time. That was what gave the Legion its true power. The magic we had just allowed us to follow through on that silent promise. We walked up the stairwell, passing forensic teams and corpses I was trying really hard not to see. Bodies were everywhere. So many bodies. their faces frozen in the moment of their death. I'd seen dead people before, but I'd never seen so many in one place. There were no wounds on their bodies, but just because this wasn't a bloodbath didn't mean it wasn't a massacre. Or a harrowing experience. One moment, these people had been walking around, and then, the next, they were dead. Just like that. Tightness tugged on my heart. I wanted to weep for these poor strangers. To let them know that someone cared about their passing, but I couldn't. I had to keep up my menacing appearance. The Legion didn't approve of breaking down into tears at the scene of a massacre. Nero's eyes, as hard as green diamonds, panned coolly across the corpses. Not a hint of emotion in them. Jace and Mina weren't as cold as Nero, but they didn't appear to be on the verge of tears, either. Their Legion parents had probably taught them to detach themselves from their humanity. Every living person we passed paused to stare at Nero. He was a celebrity around these parts, the only angel in all of New York. Most people were enamored with angels, but the police knew better. They were obviously more scared than in awe of him. They'd probably dealt with the Legion often enough to realize the truth. Angels were cold, vicious, and even more deadly than they were beautiful. I should really remind myself of that the next time I daydreamed about Nero.
Detective,
Nero said as he stopped in front of a man in a dark suit. The rest of us stood behind Nero, his silent backup. Truth be told, we were really kind of superfluous next to an angel, but I had a feeling we were here to learn, more than to actually do anything. As we stood there, I tried to keep my eyes hard, my body still and my mouth shut. It was a battle against everything that I was.
We weren't expecting you, Colonel,
the detective said. He didn't look very happy about our arrival. Okay, Nero's arrival. His wary eyes never flickered away from our fearless leader.
Tell me what happened here,
Nero said. The Legion didn't make requests, they gave orders. And if you didn't obey those orders, there was no power on Earth that could save you. So while the detective bristled at the power behind Nero's command, he complied.
The victims were all vampires, and they were poisoned,
he said. I hadn't even known you could poison a vampire.
From what we can tell, someone tampered with the magic steam system used for heating and cooling the building,
the detective continued.
They distributed the poison in the air. All 82 people died instantly. We're bringing the evidence back to the station for analysis.
No, you're not,
Nero said.
This is a Legion matter now. You will hand over all evidence to us, and your people will leave immediately. This whole building is being put under magic quarantine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.